Thank you again. And thank you all the panelists for joining us this morning. I think this topic that we have been given, trust and transparency in communication and healthcare, I've seen this up close and personal over the last 25 years, where it takes 25 years to build trust and it takes only 25 seconds to lose it. So trust is something which is extremely hard earned, and I think it's important that that relationship between a doctor and a patient remains like that. I think doctors are being perceived, or healthcare is being perceived, as becoming increasingly transactional, and that's why we have an illustrious panel with us. So let me start with Rajiv first. I think it's on. Yeah.
It's on?
Yeah. So Rajiv, thank you again for being here. And you know, maybe I'll start with you as to why do you think there is this lack of trust that is being portrayed with the medical fraternity today?
So I think there is definitely a lack of trust, and there has been what we call in marketing terms a brand deterioration as far as the patient-doctor relationship is concerned over the last couple of years. And there's several reasons. I'll try to give a few, maybe not in the particular order. Firstly, there is a changing profile of the customer, of the patient. You know, earlier it used to be the patient, today he's graduated to the customer, to more of a consumer. So as we said earlier, it was more of an ignorant patient. He told the doctor, whatever you want, you do it. Then came the era of an informed patient, that okay, you do what you want, but tell me what you're doing. Then there was an empowered patient, where he wanted to be a part of the decision-making process. You tell me what you want to do, explain the risks, etc., then we will take a joint decision, or I'll be a part of the decision-making process. Today, what we see with Googleization and information on healthcare available is the enlightened patient, where he actually starts questioning the doctor, that why do you want to do this? This is what Google says. I sent my reports to my son in USA. This is what he said. So there are more informed patients, and that is why, you know, he doesn't take the value of what the doctor is saying at face value. He tries to argue it out, etc. And very often he gets wrong information from these Google and other sources. So that's one part. The second part is that there is a lack of proper communication between the provider, and I'm not saying just the doctor, between the provider and the patient. So when I say provider, let's say in case of hospital, it's not just the doctor, it's the patient, it's the billing clerk, it's the billing desk, etc. So all this, you know, there is a, the patient is very often not explained properly what the procedure involved, what is the risk involved. And part of this is because, as Dr. Sanjay was saying, there is a shortage of doctors and there's a shortage of time. So not enough time goes in explaining the patients. Very often, even the billing is not explained very properly, that this is the expected cost, but complications may arise, so therefore it may go up. So finally, when the customer gets the bill, it's much more than what he had anticipated for, and that leads to a lack of trust. The third thing is, of course, there has been an increasing corporatization of the healthcare industry. Today, you have corporates, you know, into the healthcare industry. Profits is the motive. So there is an inherent sometimes conflict of interest between shareholder value and, you know, patient satisfaction, which happens at sometimes. The third thing is, of course, the next thing is that there's been an increasing advancement in medical science. So there were a lot of diseases earlier which were not curable. Today, they are curable. Today, they can be cured. So, you know, things like cancer or transplants or, you know, the blood bone marrow transplant, which you spoke about. These were not heard of earlier, or complicated brain surgeries. But these bring with them an inherent sense of risk and increased cost because of the technology which is used. So very often the patient doesn't understand that. He thinks that, you know, irrespective of my condition, the doctor should cure me. And very often, despite best efforts, that doesn't happen. So I think these are some of the reasons which have, you know, there could be more. These are things which come to mind, which is some of the reasons why the trust has deteriorated.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Rajiv. Dr. Saurabh, you are a, you know, practicing surgeon, and you know, you come across, you have a very close relationship with patients every day. Mm-hmm. So what has been your example of how do you bridge this gap you know, between doctors and patients?
Yes. Yeah, so see, when I was doing my training, you know, when doctors are taught, you know, how to do a surgery or how do you assess a patient, we are actually, you know, looking at curing anemia, or, you know, you are, in my case, I'm a vascular intervention radiologist. So how am I going to close this aneurysm, or how am I going to treat this varicose veins? But somewhere down the line, we forget that we are treating humans, you know, it's if you're bettering a life of a person. And, you know, 10 years ago, you know, my life changed because, you know, we realized that our son was on the autism spectrum. So then, you know, now I'm a father to two kids on the autism spectrum. So it sort of, you know, ingrained the empathy on me, and I look back and what am I doing, you know? Am I expected to just cure patients, or should I, you know, take a deeper look and understand what is happening? So then that changed my practice from a transactional point of view, where, okay, I cured your aneurysm, now you're fine, now thank you, that's it. From that to a more of an empathy-based practice, now that, you know, empathy is our main core value at the Vein Center, and I'm very proud of that, each patient which comes to us, you know, we really take some time out to explain everything, you know what your problems are. And sometimes my wife says, you don't come home for hours, you know, why do you have to know the patient's history so much, that you know what everything that they do? But then these are like, we are treating geriatrics, and you have to be more empathetic towards them. If you are just about knowing their history and knowing what disease it is and how do you treat and finish, it kind of makes it a little bit of a dry conversation. And in terms of empathy, we, you know, increasing, it helps you in more of a, you know, informalizing the relationship. The patient really then looks forward to communicating their issues. If it's not to me directly, there are a lot of chain of people who they can communicate their issues to, which trickle down to me. Okay, this fellow has this issue, so we can help them out in a different way. So when I was preparing, you know, for this discussion, and I googled, you know, how can we reduce the communication gap between the provider and the patient, you know, there were many methods, as the various apps available to ease the communication between the patients, and you don't have to travel, and then we can, you know, send messages across and all that. But that all is secondary, you know. Even without any apps, if you're just more empathetic, and if the consultants in today's hospitals are given small talks as to what will make it better for a patient, if you are just, you know, just give a little bit of 5 minutes more and listen to them, instead of just lecturing that, okay, this is what you need to do, this is that, pay this much and I'll do it. Instead of that, if you just give them a receptive ear and explain to them properly what it is going to be, you will actually know that your revenues increase and your patient conversion rate increases, because the patient trusts you better. He knows, I've seen 4 people, and you know, one of them actually threw a file at my face and told me, operation karana hai to karao, nahi to mat karao. But you're the first one who actually asked me, kab se dard hai, or, you know, uncle, aake baitho. Nobody even knows my name. Now, you know, you're the first one who actually said. And this kind of thing, you know, empathy should be ingrained to all the consultants and everybody who's coming in contact with the patient, even the cash counter, everybody. And it's free, you know, it doesn't cost you to be empathetic. It just, it makes sure that, you know, the patient understands that you care. And it is also a major factor where, you know, it can stop all these other, you know, incidents which we hear about, you know, this doctor was beaten up and this and that. It's majorly because of a lack of communication, a breakdown, and a lack of empathy shown at the time of first contact. Because if it's not that we don't have complications, we do have complications. Anybody who's practicing medicine gets complications. But if you are empathetic to the doctor, to the patient, and the patient knows that we are on the same team, you know, this guy is trying to help me out and he's doing the best he can. So I know he's a human being. If something goes wrong, I'm not going to kill him. I mean, he tried his best. So empathy first, and then taking you know, advantage of all the various technology methods that can help us reduce this communication gap and bridge the gap in a little bit of a manner where we'll all have a more fulfilling practice for the doctor, as well as a better experience for the patient as well. So that's my take on how do we actually you know, reduce the communication gap between the patients and the doctors, per se.
I think some very good points raised by both Rajiv and Dr. Saurabh on. One is the fact that today's patient is no longer just a patient, but actually a consumer. And, you know, he's seeing that the consumer experience all around is improving. So his expectation of a better consumer experience is also there with healthcare. Second, I think, is about the awareness. I think the patients or consumers are far more aware than they were before. And a very important aspect of empathy, you know, in my experience, I've seen that as long as a patient or a consumer is acknowledged and they know that there is somebody who is there to look after them, even if there is a delay, as long as the patient feels that he or she is acknowledged and that they know that, okay, yes, I know why you're here and I'm here to look after you. So some extremely good points raised. Thank you both, Rajiv and Dr. Saurabh. Let me turn to Karthik first and then to Aleen. I've always felt, Karthik, that you know, we have an ability to take an informed decision in almost every aspect of our life other than healthcare. You know that we get to see the specs of a car, you know, whether it's this horsepower or this color or this. You know, we can choose clothes on the kind of fabric that we, you know, it's made of. So there is a lot of information out there which allows us to take informed decisions. How do you think we can bring that kind of transparency in helping people take informed decisions in healthcare as well? Your thoughts on that?
Firstly, thank you, Doctor, for the great question. And it's a privilege to be here and be the youngest on the panel. We've been selling adult diapers for 20 years now. Our brands are 20 years old. So we understand how trust needs to be built over time. And in terms of transparency in communication, I think information and choice overload is very apparent to all of us in the room. It magnifies for every consumer who's out there. And trust in terms of trust with the HPCs or trust with other institutions is also a bit on the lower side. And we're all again familiar with this. So the most important thing I think is in this manner, firstly, to be very authentic and transparent in all your communications. More so, I think we have a tendency of trying to overestimate how people are comfortable with the kind of content that we put out, and their ability to digest is always overestimated on our front. So I think it's extremely important to remember who your actual consumer is. I think Dr. Bafori raised a very important point of how there are no longer patients, everyone's a consumer. So you have to endeavor to match all of your communications transparently and raise them to the standard which they're expecting from other streams of information. We are no longer in an isolated situation where we can say we have the privilege of being highly knowledgeable and we have the privilege of being in this position of doctors and we can command their attention. That is no longer the case. So I think we have to take a lot more steps in order to simplify how we converse with all our stakeholders and simplify even the kind of content that we try to present to them. In even just trying to sell adult diapers, which is a taboo subject in itself completely, two guiding principles which have always helped us through is first, always identify with your consumer mindset before anything else. And you have to understand their pains and them as a stakeholder. Only then will you be, only then can you find yourself in a position to satisfy those needs. And secondly, to be extremely authentic and direct and transparent with all your communication. It's the onus is on us to ensure that they understand and not the other way around.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Aleen, coming to you, you know, we have known each other for many years now and you know, we keep having this debate on the power of social media. But then the other day we see our Prime Minister, you know, putting his hands up, who's probably the biggest advocate of social media, saying, maybe I want to go off. I don't know if that was a publicity stunt or actually he's going to go off Twitter. And also I've been listening to, you know, various feedback on this whole how social media has blown up the coronavirus episode. So I know there are two sides to it and no better person than you to share your thoughts on, you know, the impact that social media has in healthcare communication today.
So I'll tell you a little story that happened once. First, I'll answer impact of social media. Then I'll talk about healthcare and the impact in the society with the healthcare fraternity. So I'll tell you a story. Okay. So about 2-3 years back, my daughter was about 5 years old. And she was watching YouTube and one of those Cartoon Network things on YouTube. And an ad popped up. Okay, it was of a ceiling fan. The ceiling fan had a new collection of, you know, some princess collection. You know, they had these fans with a princess collection on it. Now the ad goes like this. A little girl walks into a room. She switches on the fan. Okay. And the fan swirls around and it converts her into that princess. Now my daughter goes like, Papa, I want this fan. And I'm like, okay. I'm like, obviously, buy now. Put my new ABCD of the world, which is CVV, OTP, EMI, SOS, you know, all those things. So then after a couple of days, the fan comes. I like having random strangers at home. So I call the electrician also from online. The electrician comes, installs the fan. My daughter comes back from school. Moment of truth. She comes into her room. She sees the fan. She switches it on. And she's about to turn. And no transformation. And she's like, this goes back, switches it off again, and tries to start, turn it on again. And she's like, this fan is not working. And that's when she got the first truth test of her life, which was, don't believe everything you see on social media. I, in turn, learned two other things. I, as an agency man, or as an ad man, or a dad man, or whatever you call me, said two things are very important when it comes to social media, and especially when it comes to healthcare. One is, like how this topic has been very well curated, on trust and transparency. Now, trust and transparency in healthcare is so important because it percolates down to, I mean, these abstracts percolate down to every single aspect of healthcare. Now, if you look at the businesses of either hospitals, diagnostics, or super specialty health centers, if you see today, everybody is a keyboard warrior. Everybody, I mean, one bad episode and they'll say, "Main dal dunga internet pe aapka review." And then you see them posting all kind of stuff. Luckily, the reader is very balanced today. I mean, they want to see the good reviews, but they also want to read the bad reviews. They want to read at least one or two bad reviews so that in case they have to prepare or prevent in such a scenario, they know that, okay, the worst case scenario is that the cash guy is bad or the toilet is not clean or something like that. So they want to know. So it's good to be transparent sometimes. Don't get worked up. I mean, I would advise a lot of brands, don't get worked up if you have too many bad reviews. I mean, if you have few bad reviews, too many bad reviews, you need to work on. But few bad reviews is good. Now, when you come to brands like what Karthik has, which is adult diapers, now social media on that front has changed so many things. It's broken taboos when it comes to sanitary napkins. It's increased acceptance when it comes to adult diapers. It's increased in experimentation. Like people are ready to try hair brands and skin brands and things like that. So there's so many things happening because of social media. So it's not all bad. It's all good stuff happening. When we talk about doctors, we see doctors joining social media private groups where they're sharing information. They're sharing case studies. Doctors are learning from each other. So we see a lot of that happening on social media also. When it comes to patients, if patients use social media and search correctly, they can have such fruitful conversations with their doctors. They can manage their disease better. And so this overall scenario of social media being badgered all the time is not always the right thing, because there are so many beautiful things that can happen because of social media. And I'm very excited to see the scope and from where it goes on from here.
Great. It's good to know that we have that optimism despite, you know, whatever little cloud that hangs over social media. Thank you, Aleem, for sharing that. Let's move on to this concept of, you know, how cost and trust, you know, pricing and trust, is that, you know, sort of a tough topic. So, Rajiv, coming back to you, what is your thoughts, you know, being part of a large hospital that almost symbolizes, you know, trust in the city of Mumbai? Are these things equatable? Are they interchangeable, or are they distinct, trust and pricing, in your experience?
So definitely trust is very strongly related to pricing, but pricing is not the only factor which includes the trust. It is an important factor. And when we talk about pricing, we talk about transparent pricing. We talk about communicating the patient the pricing at every stage during the recovery process. So what happens is that there are a lot of times when you have, for various surgery, you have a package costs or bundles, and the customer, the patient may think that a CABG may cost 3 lakhs, but you know, when he finally gets the bill, it's 5 lakhs. That's because a lot of hidden things have been added when he finally gets the bill. So what we have in our hospital is that we have a very transparent system. One is we follow a single tariff policy, regardless whether you're a top corporate or if you're a patient who's coming, on your own with cash, or even if you're entitled to free treatment and we are giving you free treatment, the pricing remains the same. So we're completely transparent. We, as a principal, have not so far followed the packages policy because each and every item which is consumed is billed. So it's very transparent. The customer can see what has been used and therefore it is billed. Not only that, what happens in case of surgeries is that the doctor may estimate a cost of 3 lakhs, but there may be some complications. So genuinely, the cost may go up during the period of time. And very often, this puts the patient completely out of, it's a shock for him. Because people from the lower income class have not planned for it. So what we have a system is that at any point of time, the customer can log into our portal and see what is his interim bill. So he knows how the costs are going up, and that's why he's very much informed. So these are some of the things I think we take to ensure that, the pricing is completely transparent. It's told to him upfront. And also, I think there's a lot of need to educate the patient why the pricing is so high. I spoke about the complicated procedures and you also spoke about them. Now, the cost of equipments today, which are there, let's say a gamma knife to treat, brain surgery or a robotic surgery, a robot costs about 20 crores. A gamma knife would cost about 7-8 crores or close to 10 crores. Now, these are extremely high costs. Added to that, we said the patients have become consumers. So they not only want a good clinical outcome, they want a comfortable stay, they want good food, they want a very clean room, they want Netflix in the room. So all these cost money, and we are trying to give world-class care. And that also we are still at about, a tenth of what it will cost in the US. So all these cost money. So the patient has to be explained why the costs is so high. But having said that, if you followed a consistent policy over the last 60 years, what we've followed that, single tariff policy, communicating to the patient, billing as per what has been consumed, I think it goes a long way in building the trust.
Thank you. I think all of us can vouch for the fact that I think Hinduja Hospital has been at the, epicenter of, quality and trust. I think, and that's something which Hinduja Hospital has always stood for. So thank you for sharing that, Rajiv. Dr. Saurabh, coming to you, it's a tough, world for doctors. Sometimes they say, okay, doctor to khali paise banata hai, wo to lootta hai, how do you deal with, situations like this? What is your thoughts on that? And how do you overcome that?
So, what happens is if the patient doesn't know what he's going to be charged before he comes to see you, it will be perceived as whatever amount you say would be he's trying to extract as much as is possible from me. So they kind of perceive it in a way, if you're going to get charged 2x. And if you're not wearing a jacket, then probably it'll be like 1.5x or something. So that if the patient doesn't know or doesn't have a fair idea of what the cost would be for the procedure or the particular surgery or some medicines it's going to be, then they would just come there with a blank mind, knowing that believing that something over here is going to happen. I'll need a procedure, and this guy is going to tell me 2x what he's going to tell the other guy. So how we sort of try to beat that is because we are a super speciality practice and we treat only few diseases, it is possible for us to put our pricings online. And when a patient, before he comes to us, and 90% of our patients are search online and come to us, and when they come to us, they know, okay, these are the procedures that they might be done for me, and this is a choice. I can either go a procedure A, B, or C, and the price is listed over there. So, and this is the same for international patients. It's the same if you come from Orissa, if you come from Mumbai, whatever. And because there's no such thing as if you come down and then say, okay, if we had patients coming from Dubai and telling us, look, if I wouldn't have told you I'm from Dubai, would you have done it in say 50,000 less? Okay, no, you saw the price there and you can open the website from anywhere, it'll still show you the same. So that kind of a way is it is our sort of, a plan to how do we sort of minimize that kind of feeling with the patient. And then again, the conversation starts off on a negative note. if you're thinking already before you come into the doctor that you're going to pay more money than somebody else would, then you are on a back foot from the first day. But if you know, okay, this is what it is, and I expect maybe a 10% variation to what is displayed over here, if everything goes smoothly, then that's all right. And again, there are complications. We don't say that, you know, there'll be no complications, but at that point of time, it is explained to them, okay, we told you an X amount, but this is more complicated than before. We'll need to use a different device to treat you. So, you know, the price might go up, and then that is understandable. But displaying the prices beforehand, how much is going to be, and that may not be possible for every hospital because there are like thousands of different procedures and different doctors to treat. But being a super specialty practice, it puts us in a unique position where, you know, because your menu is small, you could display whatever is going to happen, and that kind of builds trust with the patient also.
Please.
Taking off from what he said, you know, I think there is a general perception, at least amongst Indians, that they are very loath to pay for healthcare. They want the best of healthcare, but they don't want to pay for it. Today, average middle-class family, if he goes out for a movie or a dinner, will spend anywhere between 4,000 to 5,000 rupees in a metro city. But that same family, if they want to consult a doctor in a hospital who's charging 1,500 rupees consultation fee, they'll say that, why should I pay 1,500? I'll try to postpone my appointment till it's very necessary. Then they'll justify that I went there, you know, he spent only 5-10 minutes with me and he charged me 1,500 rupees. What they don't realize is that he's spending 5-10 minutes because over 30 years he's got that experience. He's perfected in getting that experience so that within 10 minutes he can diagnose what is wrong with you and advise you the proper thing. So that's the reason why he's doing that. So that's what, you know, people don't realize, and there is a need to, you know, educate them. And added to the fact that, as we discussed, that people don't take their health seriously in terms of preventive health care. They come only when there is a problem. So all these are also, you know, factors which add to the perception that doctors are just out to make money, which is wrong, which I don't think is correct.
Like you said, you know, I've actually used that line with my patients. You know, they ask me, why is it so? You know, you're charging 2,000 rupees consultation, and if I go to somebody else, he'll charge me 500. Why? So it took me 20 years to sit in this chair and talk to you, and you know, it is what it is. And I'm not just talking to you, I'm doing an ultrasound, and I'm doing a whole bunch of other stuff. And then they kind of understand, oh yeah, I mean, it's not just 5 minutes with. But this is a quality 5 minutes that you spent, and the amount of knowledge that it required to convey to you that to find out what you're suffering from, it took 20 years for me to know that. So that kind of, even most patients do understand when you explain to it in a sort of a mild mannered way that this is what it takes. And so that's kind of a lighthearted way of trying to convey to them why it is so. We won't be very harsh in telling it took me 20 years to be here. But when you joke with them and tell, keep, you know, I sat here, you know, for me to come and sit on this side of the table, it took 20 years of studies, and then they kind of get it. Yeah, all right, you know, that's what.
So true.
Doctors, if I may.
Please, Kathir.
I mean, I think the argument extends over on the product side as well. Sustained adult diaper usage requires about 2,500 to 3,500 rupees of disposable income every month, which is a huge amount for most families. So the downward pressure on price, I mean, India is a unique beast in terms of consumers. It's very difficult to have that conversation on a national scale for a brand like us, saying, you know, for you, you think it's just a diaper, and why should I be paying close to 300 rupees for a pack? But it's a fast-paced, autonomous manufacturing system, complex with 14 different raw materials, 90% of which are imported with high-end QC at one end. So I think that pressure exists across from all of us, but that puts all the more importance of having a open, transparent conversation with as many people as you can.
Yeah, maybe I can just share a couple of anecdotes. So I've seen transparency in, you know, family physician's clinic, outside his clinic, consultation, 300 rupees, bandage, 500 rupees, phone consultation, 250 rupees. So I think that transparency, as all of you have said, I think is very important. You mentioned about, you know, how people in India are loath to spending on healthcare. So I remember when the movie Avengers came out, I think the whole Avengers experience for one individual was more than 1,500 rupees. Salim, correct me if I'm wrong. And when people come and say, how much do you charge for a pap smear with a cervical cancer screening, which is 2,000 rupees versus, you know, 1500 rupees for watching a movie. So I know, I think the mindset is still not there. So I think events like this, you know, and the media showing the healthcare industry in the right way, and I think is very, very important. I think there's a lot of good work that is happening. Media sometimes only picks up, you know, that one odd outlier, but the majority of things that are going well are not highlighted enough, I think. And that's where we need a collaborative approach with the media as well. So I think a great initiative by this platform to arrange this. Coming to you, Aleem, you know, I have always had a benchmark, you know, that in anything that I do. So whether it is, you know, if I'm going for a photography, who's the best photographer, or if I'm going cycling, who's the best cyclist. Similarly, in healthcare, I think Hinduja is clearly an epitome. But globally, I have looked up at Mayo Clinic as being sort of the benchmark for trust and quality. What has been your experience? I mean, you have any benchmarks like that and trust and quality in healthcare? And how do you try and, you know, match up to those?
So the benchmark in healthcare is changing almost every day. You know, it's like every day somebody is outdoing each other. So very recently I saw, and it's funny that I'm mentioning a fast food brand today, talking about healthcare. So there's we all had a Burger King, and Burger King last week released an advertisement which showed a burger which was 31 days old. It was full of mold, full of fungus, okay? And it said the beauty of no preservatives. So even a junk food brand, don't sue me, okay? even a fast food brand jumping onto the health bandwagon and trying to say, this ad is slated to win all awards. I mean, people have predicted that everyone just go home. This is where Khan's is definitely taking it. So that's something that's really, I mean, and how fast these, I mean, today it's Burger King, but you never know, tomorrow somebody else will come back and come back with something even better. So as of today, if I had to speak, it's Burger King. But, you know, when we work at Synapse, we consult a lot of healthcare brands. One thing we tell most of our clients is that, especially healthcare, that stop looking at, you know, what we call in marketing as USP. You know, everybody knows what is USP, unique selling proposition. When it comes to healthcare, we tell them, look at something called UST. And UST is unique selling truth. Truth that is unique to you. Truth that can create sales. And truth that you don't just talk about, but you can deliver upon. So we say move on from USP to UST, because truth is the main thing. And trust and transparency are the two pillars of that.
Extremely good point, you know, from USP to USP. Very nice. Karthik, you mentioned that, you know, you've been in the brand for 20 years now. So what's been the experience that you and your family have had, or your company's had? You know, what was the sort of trigger to start, and how has it remained, and what sort of, you know, benchmarks do you see that you want to reach to? What are the global standards that you compare yourself against, and how do you want to reach there? What's been your experience in that?
Sir, I think the global benchmark is something that we are conscious of every single day that we work. The dream still is for Noble Hygiene is to create a happier world. I think through all our products, whether they be for babies or for in female hygiene or for adults with incontinence, I think quality is what makes trust, and it's a long-term process. And like the UST concept, it's different in every consumer's mind, and it's different for every product. For us, the journey always started from the right product. I think the dream still is to deliver a world-class product to Indian consumers, wherein they don't have access to such technologies or such products in other realms of things. We were the first private manufacturers of diapers, for adult diapers in the country, and we continue to be the largest ones at that. The endeavor is always, because it weighs very heavily upon us, the responsibility that our product has, especially in adult incontinence, where a single mistake from our end can have a devastating impact. And I'm sure a lot of other organizations and doctors deal with this on a daily basis. So we have to be extremely cognizant of this. Again, touches back to what I said of knowing your consumer. And like Asif said, there's so many other avenues in where this is clearly seen. I think Mondelez with Cadbury's has done a phenomenal job. The one example wherein we all saw a national level incident in quality. But year on year down the line, I think they've managed to regain a huge part of that trust and still stand strong. So authenticity, transparency in communication, and great quality. I think as Noble Hygiene, we'll continue to strive for that.
Excellent. So I think words that are coming out is, you know, truth, transparency, honesty in communication, genuineness, empathy. I think these are all words that are coming out. You know, we have a few minutes. We can open up for questions. But if there are any closing remarks any of the panelists would like to make, feel free. But we are open for questions. I think we have some time. We'd be happy to take some questions if there are any. Can we have some? Can we have a mic in the audience, please?
Hi. My name is Dharmendra. Something very, very basic has always puzzled me. This is on for several decades now. We talk about transparency, and the handwriting of most doctors is so bad. And I'm just baffled. It's such a simple solution. All you have to do is force them to write in capitals in boxes where each character is separate. I don't even think that'll take too much money. So why has that not happened? Number one. Number two is a fantastic doctor called Dr. Atul Gawande, who wrote a book way back in 2009 about checklists. And I don't see too many doctors following that. You could have a checklist, especially as far as the prescription is concerned. Because when a prescription is written, if you can read the medicine's name, that's fantastic. That's like going to heaven. And then they tell you how you're supposed to consume that medicine. And most of them do not tell you whether you're supposed to consume it before food or after food. If there was just a proper form, in a form of a checklist, plenty of patients wouldn't die or wouldn't suffer because of such basic things. So your views on that, since we have two doctors, but it's open for all five.
Saurabh, you would like to take that on?
So actually, you know, your question about bad handwriting, well, my handwriting is not that great, but I haven't written a prescription for the past 5 years now. We use softwares to do that. We are, you know, it's done on the computer. And when you type in your, you know, it goes into the electronic health record. There are various softwares, and they're not very costly for the organization to implement. And, you know, you put in your history and your clinical findings and your investigations and all that. And all the drugs are on the menu. So when you click it, there is an automatic prompt to put in your instructions. There are instructions which are pre-fed, like, you know, if I'm writing to take a Pantocid or, you know, a acidity medicine, what time of the day you need to take in. It's a pre-fed inside, and I think, you know, most of the doctors probably would have switched by now to at least a bigger chunk might have switched to such softwares to do so.
Leelavati Hospital is not doing it.
Well, you know, I can't comment on any of this thing, but
supposed to be one of the best.
But it is easy to take the handwriting out of the way by automating it. Just, and even your notes. Now we have notes which have drop down menus, so you know you can drop down and then edit a little bit. So it also saves time. Writing by hand, if I'm going to write an A4 size page by hand, is going to take me like 20 minutes to write, and I would rather spend that time talking with the patient than actually, you know, wasting time scribbling. The only thing I use a pen for is to sign the prescription and give it to the patient. Everything else is automated. So that's probably the way to go ahead.
Yeah, but that was not a specific question directed towards you.
I'm
saying at least 90% of the doctors are not doing what you're doing.
Yeah, so I can't talk about the community as a whole. But
I can add to that. I think I would agree with Dr. Saurabh that electronic prescriptions, first of all, now I think there is a protocol on how to write the right prescription. I think there is a protocol that has been released that this is the steps in which a prescription must be written.
No, so protocol is not enough. It should be a law.
So I'm coming to that. So nobody, I think one is a protocol, and as Dr. Saurabh said, I think these protocols are now fed into electronic systems, which automatically, you know, make that legible, correct, accurate, and miss, you know, something foolproof and not something to interpretation. I was at Nanavati the other day, and I saw, you know, doctors trying to use something called as a digital pen, where everything they write get actually, you know, converted into electronic records. A lot of technology interventions are coming in. But on a lighter note, you know, doctors are, you know, we write essays when we give exams. We're supposed to write. So I guess, you know, it's just out of bad habits that those handwritings become bad. And that day somebody came to my room and on my whiteboard, I'd written down some points. And fortunately, I have a very good handwriting. So they actually asked me, are you really a doctor? I don't think you are a doctor as well. You know, and my daughter is here. She's just cleared her MBBS. They have become so objective now. Everything is MCQs now. So I think that handwriting part, I think, will see a better, results in the future. But I would agree with Dr. Saurabh. I think technology is playing a big role overall in ensuring that, these issues with handwriting go away soon. You have something to add from Hinduja's point of view?
So I think the answer is very simple. There are a lot of doctors who've been used to a certain way of operating for years, and it's very difficult to change habits. I mean, it's simple. It's just a matter of changing habits. So they are used to that. They're used to that system. They feel it's much faster. They feel that they can express their thoughts much better. They are not too much conversant, a lot of them, on the computer. And therefore, it's the adoption is not as high as it should be. There are doctors who are doing it, but there are the adoption rates are not as high as it should be.
If I may. So, I'm not a doctor, obviously, but if there was a bad handwriting association, I would be the president and founder of that. But having said that, I worked on more than 500 pharmaceutical brands till today, and I can tell you that there are 45,000 plus brands in the market. Now, what happens is that it is so difficult to get a brand name registered today, because, when a brand comes to us and they tell us that, think of a name for it, we would give up to 100 entries and all those 100 would have gone. So, what happens is that short brand names are no more available. And brand names get longer and longer and longer nowadays. And what happens because of that is, even if it's handwritten, it's difficult to understand what's written because that brand name is complicated. Having said that, even if it moves to digital, and if you actually see that brand name, you'll realize that these brand names are still difficult to understand. So it's not just bad handwriting, but it's also the number of brands that are there in this generic market in India that are difficult for any normal human being to remember as such. Like if I just told you a molecule, thiocolchicoside, not easy to, I took a lot of time to come back to pronounce that correctly. But it takes time for even to remember brand names like this. So it's not just the doctor's fault. It's not a transparency issue. It's something that's more deeper in the system, which I can consult you one-on-one. I charge quite a lot, by the way.
Thank you for that question. Thank you. So we have somebody at the back.
Hi, I'm Meher. So there was this point that was made that consumers are very finicky about the price when it comes to the healthcare industry. So if a doctor is charging extra, a consumer might not go. So I beg to differ here. I, at least from whatever I've read and whatever I've seen, of course you have, more experience. It's one of the contrarian truths that if someone close to you is going through something, you will do anything in your power to, get them the best treatment possible. Whatever you do, however you get the money, you don't really care. At that time, you want the best treatment for the person. So, in healthcare industry, how important do you think price is? Because I think it's, it goes against the law of demand. Which says greater the price, lesser the price, more the demand. Here, I think it's opposite. More the price, people think that, the services are good and hence they want to go and, consult a better, they come to these hospitals.
Can you hear me? Yeah. So what you're saying, there's a part it's partially true. But what happens is that when it's a very severe case, when it's a very severe disease, etc., you will not take the chances. You will, spend as much as possible. Possibly you will travel to another city and if you know that's a renowned surgeon and go and show your near India ones on that. But having said that, for normal cases, there is a tendency that, the doctor is charging 2,000 rupees for consultation charges. That's quite high. So if I'm going for, regular consultations, if I'm a diabetic or, if I have arthritis, if I'm going for regular consultation once in 2 months, I'll go on once in 4 months. So that kind of thing happens. But of course, if it's a serious disease, which, nobody else can cure, then I know that this guy charges 5,000, but if he's the best, I will still go to him. and I will willingly go to him. But at the back of the mind, the perception still remains that the doctor is overcharging. Yeah. You would like to add something?
No, I think we have discussed that on pricing. And yeah. We have spoken about that. So, thank you. There was a lady in the front who wanted to ask a question.
My question is for Mr. Aleem Merchant. I'm a pharma MBA student with marketing specialization. So from the marketing point of view, I wanted to ask you, today the market is saturated with brands, pharma brands, as well as FMCG products. Consumers are completely spoiled for choice and companies have moved on from the traditional methods of TV ads and print ads to social media. Today, it is the age of digitization. Everyone is on social media because people are glued to the screens of their phones. So, in this overcrowding and in this clutter, how do you stand out? How do you innovate? How do you do something different to catch the consumer's attention when everyone is there posting their ads on social media? And another point was, you said that customers post reviews of their products online, whether good or bad, and they are basically honest reviews. So, if anyone puts a bad review, you said that it is a good thing. Why? One bad review can spoil the reputation of a product, right? So, I want your opinion on it.
Sure, I'll answer your first question first, which was, how does a brand make itself unique, right? See, if you call yourself a brand, okay, you are unique. Irrespective. See, the truth is that every brand is a promise. What is a brand? At the end of the day, a brand is a promise. No matter what you stand for, you are somewhere a brand. So, even if you are the 100th or 200th or 250th brand in the market, you can find uniqueness. We come up with cases like these every day. I mean, imagine I was briefed. I had to fly all the way to Hyderabad that day to a company. And he gave me a brief on a paracetamol brand. And I'm like, you called me all the way to give me a paracetamol brief? I can't believe it, you know. But I sat with him. I understood his brand truth. I understood what is it that makes you unique. What is the genesis of your brand? Why did you even launch when you were the 250th paracetamol in this market? And as you get deeper in conversations with people, and if the brand manager or the brand management team really understands the genesis of the brand, you will be able to find brand truth. I can assure you that the plan that we've come up with for the 250th paracetamol in this market is something that's definitely going to give them sales. So if you call yourself a brand, you will always find brand truth in it. Answering your second question about reviews. You know, the last vacation that you took, I'll bring that topic again. The last vacation you took, you'd know which hotel you're staying in, and you would see the reviews of not only the good reviews, you'd also see the bad reviews. Why do you see those bad reviews? You see those bad reviews because you want to be prepared. You see those bad reviews because you want to plan just in case, are there mosquitoes at night over there? Should I carry a mosquito repellent? So these bad reviews help people to improve their services, or for brands to improve their services, or for people to be prepared for any untoward incidences that they would face over there. Now, having said that, in healthcare, it's a completely different scenario. So you should listen to the reviews. Do not ignore the reviews. Don't say that, oh, wow, I got a bad review. I'm damn happy today. It's not like that. It's more about, okay, should I address this concern? Or should I not address a concern? It's a whole new way to address these bad reviews. People take, I've sat with various brands and addressed each of these reviews. We have one person sitting in most companies answering these bad reviews only. So it happens, and one should be careful and sensitive about these things.
He said, our take is that, and correct me if I'm wrong, that if a brand, particularly service brands, product brands are different, and if you say service brands, if you see only positive reviews in any social media, there's a distrust that these reviews are manipulated or stuff like that. So any brand which is transparent, be the best airline brand, even Singapore Airlines, you'll have negative reviews. You know, it cannot be that a service brand, each and every customer is satisfied. There may be, 1%, 2%, but that will be there. And there is an option, I think, in most of the social media pages, and some of them, don't show reviews online. You can stick it off. But I think that leads to a kind of a mistrust with the brand, that they're trying to hide something. The moment you're open, that these are the customers who said this, these are the customers who didn't say that. But then each and every social media complaint which we get is taken, it is resolved, and it is posted on the net that we've spoken to the customer and it is resolved. So that's I think the way to that's what I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, to use social media and build trust with your brand.
Just to quickly address an assumption which you made at the beginning, yes, social media and online is vital and extremely important. I've personally handled about 4 launches till now. But categories and brands and names are still created very much on TV. I think it's very easy for us in an AC room living at the cusp of Mumbai to forget about the huge swaths of population that exist elsewhere in the country. And they are still very much being serviced by print and by TV and by outdoor and by radio. So digital is very, very important. Your brand lives day to day on digital. But your other mediums are where your name is also amplified to a huge degree.
I think any feedback is good feedback. And as long as the people receiving the feedback are cognizant and work on it, I think it's areas to improve. So I think we are out of time. I think the panelists are going to be here. Feel free to interact and network with them over lunch. I know there are a few questions, but we'll be happy to take them offline. Thank you again to all the panelists, and thank you for a patient audience. Thank you so much.